go into the house of the Lord. And I'm so glad to be here. Our memory verse for the week was John 14:27. And I don't know if y'all all got that or didn't, but John 14:27, the Lord said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." That is a good verse in these times of turmoil that we are going through around the world. And so thank God that we have one who can give us a peace that passes understanding, a peace that is greater than any peace that the world has to offer. And their peace is temporal, his is eternal. Their peace is limited, but his, it's everywhere. It's all the time. Whenever you need it, you can have it. All it takes is getting our eyes and looking unto him. And so I am going to ask young brother Richard to come up here and if you could do a song on the guitar before we do anything else.
Number 500.
33. Turn with me in Revival Song Book 333. Just having a good time singing this morning. We will get to preaching in a little while, but I am having a good time singing. I've been singing all morning. I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Any further, there's some folks have birthdays this week and they're not able to be in the house of God today with us, but I'm not. So we're going to sing happy birthday. So when they watch this on video sometime, they'll say that we wished them a happy birthday, okay?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
I don't remember December 16th, 1964. I don't remember that. I've got papers that say that's when I was born. But I remember on August 10th of 1987, 88, I think it was. It was after I was married 4 months. And getting married or driving didn't even get saved. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Oh, y'all didn't laugh at that. I laughed. All right, and my wife is a great wife, but 4 months after I got married, I realized I did not need a marriage to fill what was a void in my life and in my heart. Can I tell you this? It'll never fill the void. There's some parts of you that it will fill, and the voids that it will fill, but it'll never fill the void in a person's heart. Things won't fill the void in your heart. People won't fill the void. But God left a place in your heart that only He can have and only He can fill. And I'm glad He fills the voids of the people's heart as they come unto Him. He said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Matter of fact, I like that song. It's in your Psalms and Hymns and Spiritual Songs book, page number one of that. Come unto me. And it's one of my favorite songs, and I couldn't find it in either one of our song books, so we just decided to make our own. Hallelujah.
Hear the blessed Savior calling the oppressed. O ye heavy laden, come to me and rest. Come no longer tarry, I your love will bear. Bring me every burden, bring me every care. Come unto me, I will give you my
Thursday night, and we'll go a little farther in this today, and see what the Lord does for us. But he says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, according to the promise of life which is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dearly beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I served my forefathers with a pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers from night and day, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in our grandmother Lois, and in our mother Onice, Eunice, or Eunice, I don't know how exactly that is pronounced, but his mother, okay? And I am persuaded that in thee also. Wherefore, I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee, by the putting on of my hands. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound of mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor me as prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Hold fast the form of sound words, which thou hast heard of me, in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. That good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost, which dwelleth in us. This thou knowest, all that they which are in Asia be turned away from me, of whom by Jealous and Hermogenes. The Lord give mercy unto the house of Onesimus, for he oft refreshed me, and was not ashamed of my chain. But when he was in Rome, he sought me out very diligently, and found me. The Lord grant him that he may find mercy of the Lord in that day, and how many things he ministered unto me at Ephesus. Thou knowest very well. Our Father, we pray that this morning you would bless the reading of thy word. And Lord, as we get to it in a few moments, to the preaching of thy word, that thy word would be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Lord, that we would manifest you and magnify you in everything we say and do. Help our hearts on today and our mind to be consumed with Christ. I pray you do it. Lord, show yourself mighty in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Turn with me to page 201. And we're going to sing More About Jesus. How many of this is that prayer? Well, we sang Pass Me On earlier. That's a prayer song. Pass Me On. This is another one of those prayer songs, asking that we know more about Jesus.
More about Jesus would I know.
More about Jesus.
chapter 1, and I believe our text for today will be found in verse number 14. We will key in on verse number 14 and look at it in the context of the scriptures and so forth and so on. We will look at this portion of scripture and see if we can get something from the Lord that will help us along the journey of this Christian life. And he says, that good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. That good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. Our Father, again, we thank you for the Word of God, the people of God, the house of God. Dear God, most of all, for the Son of God. Thank you for loving us with an everlasting love. Thank you for saving us out of this world and out of the power of darkness and translating us into thy kingdom, the kingdom of thy Son, thy kingdom of grace, thy kingdom of glory. And I pray you help us again today in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The book of 2 Timothy, I see three things about this book as we try to understand what this book is about. He's writing to young Timothy. Young Timothy is not a preacher boy, but is a preaching man. He is a man who is now at Ephesus, I believe, in this portion of scripture, as the bishop at Ephesus. He is pastoring this church, this flock, and he's dealing with these ones, and Paul is writing him a letter because Paul's time of departure is at hand, as we will find out in chapter 4. And as Paul is getting ready to leave, he wants to leave, letting Timothy know, I want to see you one more time, dear son. I do not want to die without seeing you one more time. He tells us about those ones that had been with him, how Demas had forsaken him, having loved this present world, and how Titus had gone off to Dalmatia. And so these other ones had left, some for bad reasons, some for good reasons. But they had left him, and he's saying, Timothy, can I see you one more time? And so he's writing this letter. This letter, so I see three things that are found in this letter that he deals with, and he deals with commitment. Commitment. It's also a book of considerations, and it's also a book full of charges. The first thing we will look at, the thing we will look at today, is within that thing of commitments. This book, he says three things about commitments. He tells us there's things that we committed to God. Verse number 12. He said, for the which cause also suffered things, nevertheless I am not ashamed, for I know whom I believe and persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. When it comes to commitments, Paul was saying, I've committed some things to God. And then he tells Timothy in chapter 2, he tells Timothy, there's things you ought to commit to faithful men. Matter of fact, that's what he says in verse number 2 of chapter 2. And the things which thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. So he's telling this young preacher that it's time for him to teach others to go on to do the same thing that he had been taught to do. And then we'll see our verse. There is a commitment to us that God has given. That good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. And we will look at that portion of Scripture. But not only do I find this book is a book of commitments, but I also find it's a book of considerations. And I say that because you'll notice in the verses without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers, a consideration of him. Verse number 3. When I call it remembrance, we see in verse number 5. I put in remembrance. You'll see these considerations. He said in verse number 7 of chapter 2, consider what I say. And he says in chapter 3, in verse number 1, this know also. These are words of consideration. Remember this. He's trying to stir up that remembrance. He's trying to stir up this consideration. He's trying to stir up this, though, also. There's some things you ought to consider. And Paul is writing to young Timothy, saying, listen, there are some things that are commitments, and there are some things you ought to consider. And then we find there's charges. The most famous one that we would know are the two words here in verse number, chapter number 3. We see, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of. And in chapter 4 we will find, I charge thee therefore before God. These are charges. God has given him some charges. What are those charges? We know that one of them is study to show thyself approved unto God. A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. There's a charge. And God wants us to remember our commitments, to remember by consideration, and to fulfill the charges that he has for us in our lives. And I believe that we will find that in our portion of Scripture, that good thing which was committed unto thee, keep. You see that their consideration here that of what was that good thing? There's a commitment here that is committed unto thee. Then that charge, keep. You and I have something we need to keep that has been committed unto us. Consider all these things. Consider some things. And I want to look at that portion of Scripture as the three things we ought to consider before we keep, or before the charge, before we fulfill the commitment. I would like to probably title this, That Good Thing. That Good Thing. I like the title.